Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
All right. How's everybody doing? Well, thank you for braving the rain and coming out to our tech talk. So my name is Neil Sahota. I'm one of the proud IBMers. I actually get to work with IBM Watson and help people actually develop new ideas, new product solutions using it. But I'm also actually what they call a super alumnus of UCI. I did my undergrad and my MBA here. So I'm very, very proud to give back and still be involved in the school. So kind of just to kick it off real quick, I want everyone to kind of get energized. Give me a zot. Throw the anteater up there. Come on. You know how to do it? Ready? Zot, zot, zot. All right. So first, I'd like to thank our hosts, Dean Marios and IC Information Computer Science for helping us actually organize this event, acquire speakers, and do the invitations. I know it looks a little sparse right now, but I think as the day goes on, we have a pretty full attendance. We have a good slate of speakers for you. We do have a lunch It's provided after the speakers, then for those students, if you're interested in sticking around for the information session, you're welcome to do that. So with that, I'd like to introduce Marius.
Thank you, Neil. Let's see. I'm trying to get over my allergies, so I think I need to use the mic. Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to this half-day workshop with IBM, and thank you for participating. This is a very exciting time for ICS. The school has been growing. It will continue growing at even faster rates. So it's exciting to have corporate presence in our school and to have these kinds of exchanges. It's a great opportunity for us to learn more about what IBM does. It's a great opportunity for IBM to hear some of the things that we do in ICS. So I want to welcome everyone in the audience. I want to welcome our friends from IBM. And many thanks to Neil for taking the lead to organize this event on the IBM side. Many thanks to our external relations folks, Shauna and Kat, who are, Shauna is here. Thank you, Shauna. And Kat, I think, is outside, weathering the storm of all the people coming in to participate. So again, enjoy the rest of the day. It's going to be very exciting. And thank you. Nick.
All right, thanks, Marius. So with that, I really quickly say, how many of you guys own more than one device? And is it easy to find outlets all the time? All right. There's definitely an electrical challenge out there. And so our first speaker is Daniel Howard. He's going to talk about electricity and societal costs. So let's welcome Daniel.
Round of applause for Neil and Shauna for organizing this. Thank you. And for all of you for being here. Is the volume okay? Clear?
Perfect.
All right, great. So first speaker, you never really know who's going to show up. And so it's really nice to see you guys. I'm going to talk about electricity at the lowest societal cost. And I want to start with a question. How much does energy cost? Does anyone know how much you pay per kilowatt hour at your house? Yeah.
25 cents.
Yeah, it's about 12 is the average in the US, but close. You know how much you pay per gallon of oil in your car? Bucks, natural gas you use to heat your house, cook your food. So those are the retail costs. And today I'm going to talk about the full cost of energy. And to do it, I'm going to take you guys up to the high to a high level, to 47,000 feet up, which is the top of the troposphere. And I'm starting with this because, given current political states, there's like a little bit of ambiguity about what's actually happening with our climate. And the truth is it's very clear and it's very measurable. So this,
let's slide this up. It won't grow as much.
Okay. Is that better?
Yeah.
Great. So the troposphere, which regulates Earth's climate, is actually a very thin and sensitive layer. But we've been treating it like an open sewer and emitting huge amounts of greenhouse gases to it and effectively changing its composition. And what this has done at the highest level is created a global energy imbalance, where the Earth is absorbing 0.6 watts per meter squared more than it's releasing. So what would happen to you if you were absorbing more heat than you were releasing? You would warm. You would warm until you reached a thermal equilibrium, where you're releasing as much heat as you're absorbing. So that's what this global energy imbalance is causing the Earth to do. And it's changing climate. I've got a quick video. Shows what's happening over the last 120 years. Takeaways here are that this is measurable, it's happening now, we're the ones creating it, and there we go, great. We're the ones creating it, and 97% of scientists agree. And the big conclusion here is that we must decarbonize energy systems in order to continue to live on Earth. We have to do it to live on Earth. And the reason why is that 66% of greenhouse gases come from the energy sector. What's worse is we're expecting a 60% world energy consumption increase from 2010 to 2040. And the latest studies are showing that decarbonizing the electricity grid is not enough, that we also have to electrify transportation and industry. Right? And this is just to live on Earth in the long term, right? And again, it's all coming from that global energy imbalance, which is measurable, right? How much it warms and when it warms, the models aren't in agreement because it's hard to model the entire Earth. We don't know all the billions of feedbacks, but the trend is clear and everyone agrees. On top of that, air pollution, which is largely caused by the energy sector as well, and solid cooking fuels in developing countries, is the fourth and ninth largest contributor to global disease. Right, air pollution is the fourth and ninth largest contributor to global disease. Does anyone want to take a guess at what one of the first three are?
Skin cancer?
Close.
Water.
Water.
Yeah.
Smoking, drinking, and high blood pressure. Right. So air pollution is actually the largest non-behavioral, non-lifestyle contributor to global disease. And 87% of the world lives in areas that exceed World Health Organization standards for particulate matter, including places in the US, San Joaquin Valley, LA. And if we look at the US total mortality, right, so there's 317 million people. Looks like there was 2.6 million deaths in 2012. 30% of those were cardiovascular related, 8% of them were respiratory related, and 8% respiratory disease, 2% respiratory infections. And we're gonna look a little bit later at the air quality ties to these specific mortality and morbidity causes. So the one of the big problems, in my opinion, is that energy planning is based on techno-economic cost minimization. It's based on minimizing economic costs. And the issue here is that we're paying about 12 cents per kilowatt hour. All right, so if we had a 1 cent increase or decrease, it would be substantial, 10%. When you value the full spectrum of environmental and health impacts. Those externalities range anywhere from 10 cents to $4 per kilowatt hour. Right? So these things that energy planning is not considering are 10 to 40 times greater than the cost that it is considering. And a huge implication here is that energy planning is first and foremost a health issue for humans and the environment. But national energy organizations typically don't have insight into these environmental and health costs. And the reason why is they take a substantial amount of time, data, resources to quantify. So what are we doing? There's a lot of current solutions, ideas out there. One is limiting greenhouse gas emissions, right? Such as the Paris Agreement. Every country commits to reducing a certain amount. Another solution is a carbon credit market, right? So I'll reduce my emissions, and then I'll sell you my credits. You can keep yours the same, but that still keeps emissions at a fairly high level. There's a social cost of carbon. And what the social cost of carbon is saying, okay, carbon is creating this impact in the world. We're going to tax each ton of emissions by $5 or $20 or $50. There's a 100% wind, water, and solar initiative by the Solutions Project out of Stanford. And they have 100% renewable solutions for all 50 states and over 100 countries. And then there's electricity at the lowest societal cost, which I'm going to talk to you about today, and why I think it is an optimal way of approaching this. And I've been talking about it a lot. I'm really excited about it. So here we go. So my research is around energy system optimization. The four main components of that is, first, you've got to simulate the electricity grid and its interaction. I'll go into that on the next slide. Then you calculate economic costs. Then I not only quantify, but I monetarily value, using the latest techniques, the environmental and health impacts. And then I optimize. And thankfully, there's some brilliant computer science people here that have published some optimization algorithms. Made them available to the world. So when you simulate an electricity grid, and this is based on a study that I'm doing in Brazil, what you have is you have power plants all over the grid region. And every hour you've got to turn power plants on and off so that electricity supply meets electricity demand. The reason why is that electricity, which is a flow of electrons, is a little different than water. What I mean is when you turn off your sink faucet, the water stops. Electrons don't stop. They keep moving. That's why energy storage is such a key piece of decarbonizing the electricity grid and future grid evolution. So anyway, so after you know which power plants are running every hour for an entire year, you can go in and start to calculate economic costs. And this is zooming in on this electricity grid in Brazil, showing the transmission system and some of the energy hubs. When you're calculating economic costs, you're looking at things like capital costs, maintenance, FOM, BOM, taxes, depreciation, everything that goes into financial models. From there, I moved to life cycle assessment. And what life cycle assessment does is it looks at the emissions and resource depletion at each stage of a product life cycle. All right, so what are the emissions and resource depletion when you're mining the raw materials, when you're processing those materials, when you're manufacturing the product, when you're distributing the product, when you're using the product, when you're disposing of the product? And life cycle assessment is essentially a framework for sustainability. And you can use it for any product in any organization. And you can do your own studies. There's also a lot of studies out there. And the way it works is it looks at overall emissions across the whole product lifecycle and resource depletion, and then it maps it to 6 impact categories related to human health, biodiversity, extinction in the environment, and resource depletion. So I'm gonna show, I know you're not really supposed to show pictures like this that are big and hard to read, but I'm gonna walk you guys through it. So the way that life cycle impact assessment works is you have that life cycle inventory of emissions that you get through assessing the product life cycle. And then you look at how each emission impacts a specific impact category. So these top impact categories are related to human health. It includes ozone depletion, which leads to skin cancer and cataracts. You have human toxicity, ionizing radiation, photochemical oxidant formation. So that's ozone, smog, which you can see as you look out the window sometimes. Particulate matter formation. Right? Particulate matter is like a very big killer in air quality. And again, 87% of the world lives in areas that exceed WHO standards. The environmental impacts relate more to climate change, terrestrial ecotoxicity, acidification, eutrophication, land transformation. And all of this can be mapped to biodiversity extinction. And I don't know if anyone heard, but I guess there's a Republican bill in Congress to gut the Endangered Species Act, along with completely dismantling the EPA by 2018. And actually, I spent the summer at the EPA research headquarters, and there's a slide on what we're doing coming up. And then there's resource depletion, so fossil depletion, mineral depletion, and water depletion. So you might ask, how do we map something like particulate matter to particulate matter emissions to human health impacts? And the way we do it is we look at how changes in emissions change human exposure. Because we know the air quality concentrations, we know breath volume, breath rate. And then we look at how changes in human exposure change disease incidence. And then we look at how changes in disease incidence change health costs. So how do we map human exposure to disease incidence? We use epidemiological dose response functions, like this one here, which shows how increases in exposure to particulate matter increase the relative risk of getting diseases like ischemic heart disease, cardiovascular diseases, and cardiopulmonary issues. And if we remember that initial slide of the top 5 causes of mortality in the US, ischemic heart disease was at the top, and below that was cardiovascular issues. And a really interesting thing to note here is that the initial jump, right, so that 1.5 times in relative risk happens right at the beginning. This particular study is using cigarette smoke to estimate daily exposure of PM2.5, and what it shows is with the first cigarette, if you have it every day for, let's say, 10 years, you're getting about half the relative risk increase. So what do you think the air quality implications of that are? If 87% of the world is living in areas that exceed PM2.5 standards.
Do you have the data from China about the PM2.5 and the lung cancer? Do you have the data?
I do not have that graph, and I have not worked in China, but I have read studies on the methods that they use to quantify it, and yes, China actually has the worst air quality issues in the world, and I'm sure that it's the largest contributor to disease in China. I'm not sure, but I would guess.
India is the worst.
Is it?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, thank you for sharing. So what happens is when you wrap all of this stuff up in a model, which is what I've done over the last 5 years, is it to really simplify it, you have a technical module that simulates the electricity grid. You've got an economic module that calculates economic costs. There's a life cycle impact assessment model that quantifies and monetarily values environmental and health impacts, and then you optimize it. And there's a lot of ways to optimize it. I'm not going to talk about it, but I use for any computer scientists out there, I use a multi-chain Markov chain Monte Carlo method with metropolis selection to span the entire global parameter space. And that algorithm was developed out of UCI, not my beam. So what are some of the implications of this? As I said, I spent the summer at the EPA research headquarters, and this is a screenshot from their Enviro Atlas. It's a GIS-based database that values environmental services. And we have a collaboration to go in and for each state list the retail cost of electricity and then list the social cost, the full cost of environmental and health impacts that each state is incurring, and the breakdown of what each energy source, whether it's coal, gas, oil, wind, solar, is contributing to that. And so when I ran this model for the US, the average social cost per kilowatt hour is $1.06. So a little less than 10 times the retail cost of electricity. Right? And there's huge implications of this. Right? There's a lot of fossil fuel companies out there essentially scaring people about electricity price increases. Right? If we had a 10% increase in retail prices, right, that would be a 1.2 cent increase because we're paying 12 cents. Right? But that's at the expense of a dollar per kilowatt hour. Right, you're paying 100 times more down the line, or you're passing it off to your kids. But again, this information isn't out there. You know, people don't know that by voting for fossil fuels to very, very, very marginally reduce their short-term cost of electricity, that this is the cost that they're incurring and passing on. And it's just so fossil fuel stakeholders can get more rich. Anyways, all right, so some other implications of this. A lot of energy organizations have reasons to integrate renewables, like better air quality, more sustainable, less water depletion. But they're comparing that to numbers. Like, this fossil fuel infrastructure is $2 billion cheaper. So when you monetarily value those environmental and health impacts, you can start comparing numbers to numbers. Also, in a lot of energy infrastructure scenarios, the economic costs only vary 10 to 20%, but the environmental and health impacts can vary wildly. So you can really reduce those without actually increasing economic costs, and in the long run, make it a lot cheaper. So this model I developed can be run for any electricity grid in any country. And it's essentially what I'm promoting is revolutionizing energy planning to, instead of being based on minimizing economic costs, to be based on minimizing economic, environmental, and health costs. Which, like, isn't that like visionary of an idea? it's pretty basic. Like, arguably we should be doing it with like all public policy, but especially in a sector that has external costs that are so great. And additionally, if we're implementing policies like the renewable portfolio standards in the US and Paris Agreement numbers for climate change, I think we should be using some optimization to optimize those policies. And as a final thought, I'll leave you with, there's many, many important issues out there alleviating poverty, HIV, cybersecurity, which you're going to hear about later. But the cost to repair climate change is far, far, far greater than to prevent it. Right? Hurricane Katrina is just like the smallest example of the billions of dollars that have gone into that. And so if we don't prevent it, there's going to be far less budget for everything else, like far less. Like arguably the best thing we can do to uplift the quality of life of people in developing countries all over the world is prevent this from happening. That's it. I think I went over time. I'm okay?
Yeah.
Good. And a big thank you. There's been a lot of organizations involved here from UC Irvine, NSF, EPA, USAID, MIT, UN, my colleagues in Brazil that have been incredibly helpful at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. And I am, like anything, it takes a team of great people to do extraordinary things. Any questions? Is that a little intense for 9:30 on a Friday? Yeah.
How are you able to measure and quantify your externalities?
Good question. So I use the latest methods used by the IPCC. And essentially the way it works is we get a life cycle inventory of all the different energy production technologies that are being used on that specific grid. We look at the emissions over the year, nominalized per kilowatt hour. So things like disposal and producing solar panels are considered. And then each one of the emissions is mapped to a specific impact category. So for instance, with particulate matter formation, we look at all of the emissions that could contribute to respiratory diseases, and we represent them as kilograms of PM10 equivalent. And then we use the PM10 dose response functions to look at the impact in, you know, essentially relating increase in human exposure to increase in disease incidence to increase in health costs. And an easier way to think about that might be with climate change. So we look at the life cycle CO2 emissions, but CO2 is not the only greenhouse gas, right? Methane, nitrous oxides. And so they're all of the emissions that can contribute to climate change that have a global warming potential are represented in terms of kilograms of CO2 equivalent. And then there's a much more complicated process to looking at how that affects human health and biodiversity extinction.
Okay.
Yeah. Good question. Yes.
So is this like basically one complete package, and you're planning to like sell this package to governments or things like this to use this for their planning? Is that kind of the ultimate goal, or how?
Yeah, good question. It is a complete package, and I would like to use it to advise national energy organizations to give them what I believe is groundbreaking data that is what they need to justify making energy infrastructure decisions that are based on minimizing the cost there, you know, that is imposed on society. Am I going to sell it? That's a good question. I'm not sure. But it's more my drive's more from the impact. And I am working. I'm working with 7 different national energy organizations at the moment. And actually, that's a good question. I actually built this model based on their feedback. So it's a lot easier to find a market and then develop a product than it is to develop a product and then find a market. So based on the interviewing and their common questions, themes, issues they needed help answering, I went and developed a model to address it.
So isn't that like an IBM product there?
No, this isn't. Yeah, thank you for asking that. And John?
What countries are doing particularly well according to your measure? I mean, I can look up CO2 footprint. That's easy, but if we think about this broader array of quality measures? Are any countries stand out as being good at it?
I wish I've had the time to run this for more countries and had the data. In South America, South America has 25% of the world's water and 5% of the world's population. And they use, so because of all the water resources, they have a lot of hydroelectric generation, which not only has low CO2 emissions, but also, you know, very low life cycle emissions in terms of human health impacts. So they're doing pretty well. So for instance, in Brazil, so while we're paying $1.06 per kilowatt hour in externalities, Brazil is only paying about 8 cents. I would guess other countries like Denmark, which has one of the highest renewable penetrations in the world, I think about 70%, are also doing very well. And that's William and I. All right, that's something we're working on. Yes?
On the comparison between Brazil and the US, I'm just curious. So if you look at your model here, you're looking at healthcare costs. Presumably, when you do this for the US, you're looking at US healthcare costs. Mm-hmm. Brazil, you presumably are using the Brazilian healthcare costs, which may be dramatically different.
Yes.
The value of life may be valued differently and so economically, right?
Yeah, exactly. We look at changes in the medical costs indexes and consumer price index, and when deriving a value of a statistical life, it's one of the most controversial things. I think a president of a very large government organization had to retire because of a comment about that. The way that my model does it is it takes the standard value of a statistical life in 2015 dollars for 2015, published by the EPA, which is $9,500,000. It then uses a 0.4, what's called an income to willingness to pay to avoid adverse health effects elasticity, which is 0.4, which basically says as your income increases by $1, people are willing to spend 40 cents of that on avoiding adverse health impacts. So using that, I develop a VSL for Brazil. And then using the average life expectancy, I derive a DALI, which is a disability adjusted life year value. And that's it's a united measure to measure mortality and morbidity. So if a 75 year old dies and the life expectancy is 78 years, you have 3 DALIs. If a 3 year old dies, you've got 75 DALIs. And that's a way to start, you know, essentially quantifying morbidity and mortality with a unified metric that has a monetary value placed on it.
Great.
Yeah.
One additional question. Would you mind maybe saying a little about what part of IBM you're in and what your background is? Because there wasn't much of an answer.
Yeah, sure. I'm not with IBM, although I'm so happy they invited me to speak here and put this event on. I'm a fifth year PhD student at UC Irvine in the Environmental Engineering Department. And I raised funding from the National Science Foundation and USAID and some others to do this research. And so I've been very fortunate to be able to do research that most companies aren't paying for and to not be tied to a certain direction.
Great,
thanks. All right, I'm afraid we're out of time. So let's go to Daniel. Thank you very much. If you have more questions, I mean, Daniel, I think will be here for during the lunch.
Yeah.
Lunch, so please reach out and engage him. While we're getting the next speaker set up, I just want to make a couple of comments. You guys can switch if you want. She's not here yet. All right, then I'll have to keep stalling. you know, we always hear a lot about green tech and all these kinds of things, but you know, there's some real serious challenges out there. If you think about non-functional requirements. We always talk about security, we talk about performance. You know, we need to start thinking about not just energy consumption, but carbon emission and other things that might impact our planet. And while we're waiting for our next speaker, let me just call out John Graham. John, if you wouldn't mind staying up. He's the executive director of the Center for Global Leadership. there are guys that actually champion these types of causes, very active in the university. John personally means a lot to me, actually. He was my mentor when I was in business school. For better or worse, helped shape a lot of my life. It's had a tremendous impact. And actually, the class I took with him, International Negotiations, was the best and most useful class I've ever taken for my career. So if you don't know John, I definitely encourage you to reach out to him when you get a chance and at least learn a little bit more about him and the Center for Global Leadership. So thank you, John.
Thank you. Thank you for sending all this out.
So while we're waiting, I guess let's take just a quick couple of minute break here and we'll get started. Start about 10:15, so if you want to grab some food, take a bio break, please go ahead, and we're going to talk, we're going to launch our next speaker at 10:15.
Like 5 weeks, I'll spend somebody else.
Everybody, we're gonna get restarted. Unfortunately, our next speaker had a bit of a family emergency, so we're doing what all good entrepreneurs or entrepreneurs do: we're pivoting. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Arvind Sathi. He's with IBM, and he's actually gonna talk a little bit about cognitive computing. So let's give him a warm hand.
Okay, I need all the luck here because I was told about 2 minutes ago that I need to speak. So, I thought about it and I said, well, UCI, that would be a good crowd to talk about, but what should I talk about? So I wanted to introduce myself. I'm part of the Watson team at IBM. We invested about $1 billion to compete in the Jeopardy, and we eventually did manage to do that. Then the question was, how do you make business out of that? It's a great thing to compete with people on Jeopardy and figure out how to read any information, but making sense out of that and making business sense out of that, that's a challenge that some of us have. So that's a work that I'm doing right now. I'm working with a number of very strategic partners to take a number of our work in this area. So we kind of started in 2011 time frame. We started with the original Jeopardy work. Oops.
And Arvind, can you put it in the screenshot? It'll be a little bigger.
Yeah. And what I'll have to do is there a somewhere I can steal a power supply here, because otherwise I'll keep going to sleep. Or rather, my machine will go to sleep. Okay. All right, so what I was talking about was the kind of role that we have been given. So 2011, we created this interesting marketing machine around us, because we said we can do work that humans do. Beating experts in Jeopardy was not easy. However, then we were given a little bit of venture money from within IBM. It's internal venture money, and we were told, go out, guys, go and make a business out of that. And we were wildly successful. So the good news is we have been able to convert it. And a lot of what I'm going to talk about it is, what is meant by cognitive? How do you go about doing it? I'll also do a little marketing for my own book. It's called Cognitive Things. It talks about how Internet of Things are becoming cognitive. And I think later you'll have a presentation on Olli, which is one of the devices that we have created. It's a bus that works driverless in the city of Washington, D.C. We have this bus running around, and you can ask all kind of questions like, where are we? I want to go to X, Y, and Z place. So for example, I'm working with another company in the map area, TomTom, where they supply the map services to companies like Uber and Apple. And what we would like to build is, on the top of that, some interesting cognitive capabilities where you can ask questions like, hey, I'm interested in Chinese food. What's the nearest good Chinese food I can eat? And I can get into a little conversation before Uber or Apple Maps or somewhere, something tells me how to go to the nearest Chinese restaurant nearby. So what we will talk about here is some of these capabilities in terms of how we go about doing that. And one of the areas that we saw very interestingly was that a lot of the work that we do as humans is working a lot with text, images, and sensors and devices. So if you take into account what we did in the good old days, a lot of the work we did was with structured data. We used simple data structures, created into tables, and we had, you know, maybe gigabytes or petabytes of data in different corporations, and we were able to analyze that. But most of the data today is not structured. Some of it is unstructured text. Some of it is images, and a lot more of that is sensors and devices. Let me give you an example. So for example, every time you use your smartphone to look at a Facebook page, do you know how many events you create for a telephone company like T-Mobile or AT&T? It's close to 300 events that they can track out of your phone for that single page access. So one of the exercises we did was we said, let's go to one of the telcos and find out what happens if we collect all those events from all those phones. And of course, then we will be able to do all kind of interesting analysis with that. And that belongs to that sensors and devices area. We found that the amount of data that we were getting in that environment was about half a terabyte per second. Half a terabyte per second is not the kind of data you can store in a repository of some sort and do simple queries on that, because now you're talking about data that is going to flood it so badly that you need big pipes, you need to be able to analyze it. So a lot of what we are seeing in terms of the sensor and device data is we have to have different mechanisms to understand, to recognize, and to filter information in such a way that we can recognize things that we really care about. When you go to a particular event, so for example, many of you may remember you went to your birthday party, and some of you vividly remember what kind of clothes you wore. I don't. I somehow completely blank out on that. But I remember people's faces, and sometimes I don't remember the names, but I remember such and such face and the background that person had and which city they lived in. So we all have a way of focusing and filtering in whatever way we do. And that's a human characteristic that we are trying to pull in our Watson IoT group, where we can start to have machines do something similar to what we are doing. Same thing with images. We have now the ability to go out and look at images and figure out what those images are doing, how to classify those images. For insurance companies, it's very important for us to be able to take a picture and say, my windshield is broken. If my windshield is broken, the picture itself tells me that. And so the insurance company can look at that and assess whether it's a big windshield broken or a small one broken. And that's a kind of analysis that if a machine can do it, then it's a definite aid to the person who's doing the assessment of claim. We did something really fun with that for one of the matchmaking websites, where people put in their personal information. Sometimes they put their photo, they don't tell what they're doing. Can I look at that picture and realize that this person is doing rock climbing? So maybe I should match that person with somebody else who's outdoorsy like. Think about it. There are interesting implications in terms of how we use this information. To give you something. So one of the key questions people ask is, Arvind, so what's going to happen to us? We are going to have all these machines which are going to start excelling everything that we do. So what happens to people after that? Now it so happens that machines are very good at doing certain things, but not everything. So we have a very good chance of using, in the past we did mathematical tables, and now we use calculators. If I ask anybody in the room what is 19 times 19, chances are very low that you will, on the top of it, recall that. However, many of us remember that. In our early childhood, we all were sitting and memorizing those tables. Same thing is happening today. We are basically shifting the balance in terms of what people do versus what machines do. People are very good at common sense. Machines are not that good at common sense. Models. So I have just tweeted yesterday a very interesting question about social responsibility for machines. By the way, my Twitter handle is at Dr. Arvind Sathi, if you feel like following it. I often provide a lot of interesting information about Watson and other sources. So please feel free to follow me on Twitter. And what we are finding is that models are something that people worry about, and you can teach machines a little bit of social responsibility, but machines have to somehow follow the advice of where we go with that. We are very good at imagination. We are very good at compassion. So these are really the kind of skills that it will be much harder to teach the machines. However, machines are very good at locating knowledge. If you have got lots and lots of data, so Watson, for example, there is a API that I can introduce you to, which is Alchemy. And you can use Alchemy to look at last 60 days of news from about 60,000 different sources. And you can look for any information that you want to get to, and it can locate it, search it for you. That's an example of locating knowledge, because what you are able to do with these is not just able to get to a particular website, but read that website, find out exactly what it is talking about, start connecting the dots when you find one news item talking about something, another news item talking about the same person, you can start connecting the dots there. So that's a good example of locating the knowledge. Pattern identification. If the machine knows what kind of patterns have to be recognized, it can go out and find it. I basically call it finding a needle in the haystack, defining the needle, and then going and saying, go and find the other 50 needles in the haystack. So finding the first needle is a human task, but finding the next 50 needles is a piece of cake for a machine to do. Natural language comprehension. One of the things that we are seeing a lot from IBM, from Google, from other sources, is our ability to start to understand natural language. And it also translates itself into language translation. So if I can understand natural language in one language, I can maybe start to translate it to another language. machine learning. So this is an area where we are beginning to figure out ways by which machines can automatically go out and look for patterns and start deciphering those patterns. A lot of these techniques are at a level where you can treat it like a black box. I may have a lot of documents and I may like to classify them. I can only look at a couple of them, I can categorize them manually, and then I can tell a machine, based on what I did, just go out and do that. So we have software like that, which is very easy to use, where we can use the word count, the way the words were used, to start classifying documents. And that's a very good example of machine learning, where we can start to use machine learning as techniques to reduce down the size of the documents we may be looking at. Eliminating bias is a very good one. The previous speaker, I really loved the way you presented the model and you talked about how a very structured approach you could get the social cost. To me, that was an example of eliminating bias, where people may have a bias, they may not fully consider everything, all aspects of a particular model. And that's what machines do very well, where we can start to take information, organize it, give you very, very objective way of looking at that information in a very unbiased way, presenting a view which covers many dimensions that you may or may not be thinking about as a human, and thereby a biased human can be corrected through this. Last but not the least, endless capacity. Machines have the ability to go out and work forever. You can scale it, you can apply a lot of machines, you can work 7x24. They don't take a break except for scheduled or unscheduled maintenance. So this is where we have the ability to apply the capacity. Okay, what else can we talk about here? Let me see if I can pull an example. Let me take a very specific idea in terms of how we would teach a machine to work through. And what I'm describing here is essentially the ability to go and read certain paragraphs, trying to find key entities, expanding on those concepts, and exploring. So essentially what we are beginning to do is take something like what you're seeing here in the sentence. Can I read that sentence? Can I make sense out of that sentence? And can I extract key entities out of that? So let me expand on that a little bit more. These are all the capabilities that we have in APIs today in what we provide. For that matter, there are a number of companies which are providing these kind of APIs. So outside of IBM Watson, some of these capabilities are also there with Microsoft. Google is providing some of those capabilities. So there are a lot of sources you can do. In the Watson environment, there is a site called bluemix.net, blue, B-L-U-E, blue, M-I-X, bluemix.net. And anyone in UCI can get a student can get a 6-month trial license, a teacher can get a 12-month trial license. You can get over 100 plus APIs which are there in Bluemix. What I'm going to do through this is to explain some of those APIs, and you're more than welcome to go and try it out and apply it on your own. So for example, emotion and tone. If you have a text or if you have any kind of conversation, we can apply this API, the tone analysis, to find out the tone of what the speaker is feeling in terms of the sentence. And the way it does it, it uses the type of text, the type of words that we use, how it was structured, to come back with a tonal analysis. Looking at key entities and concepts and relationships. So this is another API we have called Alchemy, which can be used to analyze and find out key entities. One of the things we like to play with is news. So if I want to look at all the news items and I want to start looking at going back to the Star Wars, if I've got a certain kind of concept in Star Wars, if I want to look at all those key entities, extract it and find all the news items, start connecting them together in a graph, that's the kind of the work that we can do there. Ask questions and interact in natural language. An API that we have developed called Conversation allows us to do a natural language conversation. So this is where we can apply natural language understanding to differentiate that whether somebody is saying, my password does not work, my account is locked, or I cannot log in. All of these sentences mean the same thing, which is, I just don't know how to log in and help me out with that. So then you can start getting into a dialogue based on that. So that's a natural language understanding example. Language identification. We can use the API to understand which language you're speaking in, and then we can start getting into a deeper understanding of author's personality. So the personality insight application allows us to do that. I've been using it to look at resumes, for example, where I can analyze a resume and come back and tell you what kind of a person you are. So be careful what you write in your resume, because somebody could be analyzing your personality out of that. Okay, that gives kind of a little feel for that. I didn't want to go too much into the products themselves, because what the purpose of this talk is more to give introduce you to the cognitive work. And I wanted to give you just enough of the play part of it using Bluemix so that you'll have a feel for what kind of capabilities you can get. And as I said, this is a very competitive area, so these products can be found from a number of sources. IBM is not the only one. Of course, with the Jeopardy work that we have done, we do have certain edge in the marketplace at this stage, so we are working with universities to continue to build that, and this is one area where we are working closely with UCI, as one of the universities, where we are giving you access to this these technologies, and we are hoping that we can work together in a number of these areas. I will be teaching a course, so this is one thing that is probably worth talking about here. Neil and I will be talking about teaching a course in analytics consulting in the business school, and we'll teach students in that course how to build a business case out of this. Because what I showed you were some very interesting capabilities, but any dollar and cents company would come back and say, okay, Arvind, so come and tell me what does it really mean to me? What kind of employee productivity I can get out of it? Can I make more revenue out of that? Can I do better social responsibility with that? So business case could be in any of those areas. And a lot of the work that I'm doing is in terms of taking these capabilities, converting them into business concepts, figuring out how it makes a difference to the world, and then putting that into a succinct story so that somebody can decide on what technologies to use. So this course will be taught in the April timeframe. Any questions, any observations, any? Yes?
Yeah, earlier I heard you mention about moving from cognitive computing towards a cognitive IoT. Can you elaborate on that topic?
Yes, very much so. This is my favorite topic. So I was, because as I mentioned earlier, my book is called Cognitive Things. So I was trying to combine the two concepts. So an earlier chart I showed you was where devices and sensors are providing a lot of information. A lot of this information is not necessarily structured. It is not necessarily unstructured. It is somewhere in between. Semi-structured is how we call it. But it's a lot of information. So I've got my Apple Watch here, and the Apple Watch, every time I'm breathing, it's taking some kind of a measure, and every so often I get this thing coming back and saying, breathe, Arvind. And it's interesting that this is a piece of information that the Apple Watch is creating, and somewhere along the line, this information is being evaluated, it has been collected, it has been collated, analyzed, and then the breathe instruction comes back. So cognitive things are all about how we can start from these sensors, collect the data, focus and filter that information so that we are able to put that information into meaningless observations we can make out of that, and then act on that. In my book, I talk about elderly care. This is one of my favorite areas. And elderly care is a very important area because very often elderly are by themselves in their house. And what we would like to do with Internet of Things is to monitor their behaviors and find out what they're doing, not for a bad purpose, but only to make sure that they are able to go to the kitchen, open the refrigerator, eat food, that there is some movement going on. And if there is no movement, then we can alert somebody and say there's no movement there. So this is a good example of where Internet of Things can help elderlies. But then the next question with that is cognitive computing. Do I really want to use it to give a lot of false positive information to somebody who's unnecessarily going to the elderly's house? Or can I start analyzing, correlating, taking advantage of any unstructured or structured sources of data I have, putting it together, and maybe start getting into a conversation with the elderly himself or herself, and make sure that we have a way to take care of them rather than simply act like a robot in that situation. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, I have a follow-up question. Right now, what I heard from industry, especially in Silicon Valley, a lot of investment going into the edge device to bring the intelligence to the edge, not in the cloud computing side.
Yes.
This is that is the one of the major growth areas. What do you see the cognitive IoT at the edge device?
It's a very important concept, and this is an area where a lot of research is going on. There are a number of advanced products in this area. So two examples in that. Number one was a telephone example I gave earlier where Facebook is creating 300 images, or 300 network events. The edge device would take those 300 events and convert it to a single event, which is somebody access the Facebook, which is what we may be interested in that situation. So that's a job that the edge device does. And for example, we have a product in that area that allows you to do that kind of analysis. The other example I want to give you is driverless cars. So anytime you will be using the driverless cars, or for that matter, driver-assisted cars, there's a lot of events that are being created in that environment that through the OBD2 port we can collect. The question is how much of that information we collect and what do we do with it? Because most cases we want the car to be a self-autonomous car. We don't want to have a central authority controlling the car, but at the same time we would like to have some level of analysis. So this is a good example of an edge device where a lot of the automobile companies are working in that area to make sure that the edge devices can collect information, but then act on that right at the edge.
So in that case, the cloud is not in the loop.
The cloud
may not be in the loop. So if you push the cloud intelligence back to the edge, what is your take on that?
Right, so there are two interesting collaborations that are required. That's a very good question. One is that we would like the edge device to provide an insightful information back to the cloud. And the second thing is that the cloud may have way of providing a way the filtering would work back to the device. So for example, I may have, going back to the driverless car example, I may have certain things specifically happening in a geographical area, and I may instruct the device to look for a traffic jam or look for an accident or look for a stopped vehicle or something like that based on something I may have collected from other places. On the other hand, the device has a responsibility to come back to the cloud with only meaningful information that the cloud requires. So this becomes more like a human communication. When Neil and I communicate on doing a course together, we don't talk everything. We filter before we talk. But at the same time, we have a way to understand in a human way how to communicate with each other. That's basically what's happening with between the device and the cloud. Yes?
Very interesting presentation, and I'm trying to understand if there are limitations to cognitive computing, you know. And so one of the things that we've seen in the last few months are there's new ideas coming in to understand what text means. In particular, we see these now things called fake news, alternative facts, and the hateful tone of news. So how does, you know, is Watson going to eliminate the bias there or be able to tell us what's really going on? Because I can imagine if I'm a corporate executive, I need to know, like, what's real or what's fake because we may be making investment decisions. So your opinions on that.
Okay. So the first question you asked, which is very important, is are there any limitations? And of course, there are lots of limitations. Some of those I had talked about, and then as we get into that, we find that cognitive computing is still an oxymoron. I mean, it can do certain things, but after a certain point in time, you say, why can't I give some common sense? And there's no common sense there. So that's the thing to watch for. Eliminating bias is a good one. So I'll give you a simpler example to fake news, and then we can apply it to fake news. So you go to Yelp, you look at ratings, and how often you go and do a little bit of digging in, either using unstructured information that is there in the comments or some other way to find out if there are a couple of 5 stars to a particular facility. Is that a biased or an unbiased? And I have my own rules, and I'm pretty sure that all of you have your own way of figuring it out. And you can differentiate and filter very easily and say, well, there are 10 positive recommendations, and it looks like they were all 10 friends of this person. To me, that's a fake news right there. How can I spot that? There are systematic ways in which a cognitive computing device can help a corporation figure out what to trust and what not to trust. And that particular piece of area is something that is within our reach today. We do not really have a lot of implementation, but I think fake news is really becoming very, very important topic in the last couple of months. So I'm sure we are going to see a lot of implementation of this area where we will be able to start to rate that information. For an accounting firm I'm working on, we have a mechanism to apply human judgment to a statistical understanding. So we can combine the two together to start to formulate a common machine-man way of thinking about how to judge, in this case, court decisions. So there are different circuit courts, as you know, in the US, and each of them decides, and very often we don't know who to trust and who not to trust and where to apply certain tax rulings and all that. And that's the kind of stuff we are working on. So this is a good example where we should be able to look at conflicting news items and figure out what is real and what is not. Yes?
So I had two things. One's, so looking at the slide up about what humans excel at and what machines excel at and the cognitive computing. And on kind of the human side was kind of morality and empathy and all these things, which I'm not sure how, in terms of jobs and careers, how we make that turns into, you know, things that you can be marketed as, oh, my skill is empathy, or, you know. And so there's still kind of a question to me about the long-term implication of jobs in that sense. And also, you know, they have, I was looking, reading about some of these computers, like companies, the IBM, HP, where they're kind of making computers that operate kind of like, you know, the brain you're talking about, kind of adding human elements. And so as we get to machines that now can operate in the same kind of way as a human brain, they pair those with these other machines, what does the research to break, lose some of those limitations that, you know, for also, there's another area where maybe humans are getting pushed out, and you see that also being pushed out as well. So I guess they see, considering those factors, you know, you still have things, you know, humans, how you still see the opportunities for humans in the future with.
Right. So basically the question you're asking is, if machines take on certain skills, do we need to change the skill set that humans offer over time? Are there going to be certain human skills that will be more valuable in the future versus less valuable in the future? And I want to give you a story from the past. In 1960s, when I grew up, there was a typing school next to my house. And I was very curious, so I said, I want to go and learn typing. And the guy who was teaching there, he said that, Arvind, you are a very smart kid, you're going to become an engineer. Why do you want to learn typing? Typing is for people who don't know how to do engineering work so that they can get a living. And there were typing pools in those days where pool of people who they all go downtown, they will sit down in a pool, work on their stuff, they will do shorthand typing and make a living. Do we have any of those typists today? No. That skill is now incorporated in how a teenager is very rapidly doing texting, and what they're doing there is actually nowhere close to the QWERTY typing that we learned in the school those days. It's very different. So we are already witnessing how automation changes the way our skills are valued. An entire class of people got completely eliminated by the advent of word processors, where people started to become their own typists, and they did not need a third-party person to sit down and do that. Same thing is about to happen with a number of these tools. So call centers is a good example. We had lots of call centers. We ended up outsourcing a lot of that to Philippines and India. And now we are coming back with a new way of thinking, and we are saying, gee, do we really need all these people? Because they don't really have as good an understanding. They don't have the empathy. They don't know exactly what is happening. Is there any way by which we can start to eliminate some of the call center jobs, because those jobs are not really providing that same level of service? However, machines with people collectively can do a far better job at a far higher productivity level than where we are today. If the only thing you want to do is a little help in login, it's a standard set of rules that somebody has to follow, a machine can do that. If I really have a really difficult question, I want a person, and I really want that person to take care of me. And 90% of the call center conversation are the first variety, not the second variety. So what you're seeing there, again, is a movement of skills. So going back to your question, it's not simply a question of softer versus harder. It's a question of what skills are going to be more suited for human work versus machine work. In my book, I talk about Federal Reserve Board in St. Louis did a very nice study of cognitive jobs versus non-cognitive jobs and how they're changing over time. And you may like to look at that statistics, because that is a very interesting statistics on how things are changing over time.
I'm afraid we're out of time.
Okay.
I think Arvind, if you're around for the lunch, I'm sure a lot of people have questions, so you can reach out to them then. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks. So our next speaker unfortunately had a little bit of an accident, but he's going to be coming in via like a video conference. His name is Joe Speed. He's with IBM, and he actually works on Olli. Has anyone heard of Olli before?
Well, Arvind mentioned this.
Well, then everyone should know. All right, so we're going to get Joe hooked up here in a second. But has anyone seen Olli before? Well, you guys are in for a treat. So while we're, give us a minute here, just get the sip of while we're waiting. How's everyone doing?
Good.
Good, a little tired. It hasn't really started raining yet, which is good, and maybe it won't. I don't know about you guys, but for whatever reason, I feel like it doesn't rain as much in Irvine as it does everywhere around Irvine. Give us a minute. Feel free to grab some more food or drinks while we're waiting?
Hi, this is Joe. This is Yeah, and it's staying in your personal privacy. The house has never been used in August, but it's not good. Okay.
It should just be the same.
It could be, or it could be that he used his. He can have a personal meeting identifier. He may have used a different ID on it.
I can log into my email and get it. I'll log into my email and click on the icon. Okay. Let me try that right now. We'll get back to you if it doesn't work.
We'll keep him on the line.
Yeah.
This is crap. I can give you my email. I can start up a session that you can connect to.
Okay, thank you.
All right, we're ready to go, guys. The joys of technology.
Can you hear us?
Yes, good morning.
Okay, so now you have to get the... plug this into the...
We're still setting up here.
Say something, Joe. Which microphone?
It seems to be working, right?
Yeah, but we're not cutting it out from here. How do you want to get it out?
Just a second.
Here, let's...
Good. Okay, can you hear us now?
I hear you just fine.
Oh, okay, good, here we go. Okay.
So should we take a start?
Yeah, I think you're ready to go.
Okay, very good. Hey, really appreciate it. I had every intention of being there. In fact, I skipped our Watson IoT grand opening in Munich to be there today, but then events conspired against me this morning. So apologies for that. But I'm very excited to be talking to you all today about some topics that I care about quite a bit, and hopefully you might find them interesting as well. So let me go ahead and share my screen. I'm not going to do too much around the PowerPoint aspect of things, but okay. And can you all like wave a hand if you can see a slide with a picture of a bus. Okay, I think that's critical mass. So I'm Joe Speed. I'm the product owner for the Watson IoT AutoLAB, and I'll talk a little bit about that. And some of these topics here, the Meet Olli, Accessible Olli, or if you want to find out things we're up to, my Twitter handle's a good place. There's some of my contact info, but honestly, Twitter DM is probably obviously always the best way to reach me. Real briefly, what do we do? So this group, we're actually, we work across the organization. We've got people from IBM Research, Watson, Watson IoT, IBM Interactive. We all work together with our partners, our customers, to do design thinking driven rapid prototyping, so co-creation. So think, you know, their designers, our designers, their developers, our developers, and we're together in the same room, in the same GitHub, building these things together very quickly. And so some examples of things that we've done, there's some things we're involved in with BMW. So we've got a whole fleet of i8s and a bunch of BMW research people that work alongside my folks in Munich. We are doing some interesting things with Panasonic around cognitive cockpit, the Fiat Chrysler portal, the EV people mover. And today I'll talk to you about something that is really quite interesting, but instead of listening to me, I think what we'll do is we'll, if you can go ahead and play the first video, we'll let James Corden tell you about it instead.
I'm just waiting here, there should be someone called Olli coming to pick me up. Olli?
Hello, James.
Who's that?
It's me, Olli. Please have a seat.
Right, where's the driver?
I'm the world's first cognitive, self-driving shuttle. And I'm electric. I'm the future of travel.
Is this your only voice? Can you do any other voices? Can you do a Tennessee accent?
Hey y'all, who wants grits?
I mean, honestly, I don't always trust my driving. Why would I trust a computer?
Because I don't drink, text, or get tired.
So how do you flirt with other buses if you don't text? Is that your laugh? Thanks so much, Olli. Thank you. Hello.
So I thought that might be a little more interesting for than typical talking head videos. The and it is a pretty good depiction of what we're working on, where we're going with this. And so I'll show you a little bit about how we go about this real quick. Let's see, share screen, and look. Okay, so what is Olli? It's a cognitive, self-driving, it's autonomous, it's EV, it's about 40% 3D printed, and it's neighborhood mobility, right? So you don't use it to go, it's not for places that are further than, you know, 10 minutes away, right? So it's not taking you across the city, but think about, you know, on your campus, in your neighborhood, around the airport, these kinds of situations. And where does it come from? So there's this really interesting company y'all should take a look at. It's called Local Motors. And what they do is crowdsource industrial design and direct digital manufacturing of vehicles. They also do this as a white label business for other industries. So for example, all of Airbus's new commercial drones are coming out of Local Motors design collaborations and prototyping. Also a lot of GE products. So GE First Build is a joint venture between Local Motors and GE to do crowdsource industrial design, rapid prototyping of home products. So Local Motors ran a mobility challenge for Berlin to try to imagine what their Berlin's needs, what is the challenge for the year 2030. And they had a bunch of designs, some pretty interesting stuff. One of them, this is the bicycle tree. So in Europe especially, and probably there on campus, you find areas where there's so many bicycles all crowded together and there's no room to move. So instead, turn the problem, you know, vertical and create this bicycle tree where what you do is you walk up, you press a button, you pull out your mobile, it drops a cable, hook it up the front tire, it takes it up, and when you come back later, it drops your bike back to you. And so it's not congesting the ground, it's not using the ground space, and it's not allowing bicycles to be damaged or stolen. So you should build one. And then there's Berlino. So this was designed from Edgar Sarmiente. He's a Italian industrial designer, 22 years old, living in Bogota, and he created the winning design. And then here he is with it not long after with Olli in National Harbor for the launch that we did, with local motors did, and we help. When I say we, it's mostly them, right? But we help. And so one of the questions though is, if it's a self-driving vehicle, who do you have? Especially if it's public transit, right? Who's the bus driver? How do I get my questions answered? And what we came up with is you give it a cognitive experience using Watson. And we have a lot of history with local motors. So a quick bit about myself. I work at IBM and I like cars. So IBM lets me build cars for IBM. And you know, I think it's so amazing to work for a company that allows me, that gives me the tools, the ability to do things that I care about. So one of the first things we did with local motors is an open source vehicle with open source electronics and open source Internet of Things software. So think MQTT, Node.js, you know, all of these kinds of things, in vehicle, in the cloud, all working together. Next thing we did together was a 3D printed vehicle with a proximal IoT mesh in vehicle with sensors, actuators, and also an obscene number of RGB LEDs in cockpit and under the car, and we wired it up to the cloud so that the car would glow different colors depending on traffic. And then the one in the middle at the bottom you see, this was a fun one. So UNLV, the UNLV Robotics Lab, they have Hubo, Metal Rebel, which is a humanoid robot. And what we did is 3D printed Hubo his own car, and then I got IBM to chip in and help UNLV to so that Hubo would know how to drive his car. So the soundbite on that is, who needs a self-driving car when you can just let your autonomous robot drive for you? Yeah? And then these things bring us to Olli. So for Olli, think about this process, right? That it's, you know, there's something called Joy's Axiom that's paraphrased, wherever you are, the smartest people aren't. Like, no matter how smart you are, no matter how good your team is, there's someone else, there's someone somewhere else that has a better idea and is smarter. And so what Local Motors does is, just like we do in the software community, you're all familiar with open source software, well, they do open source industrial design. So allowing people all over the world, right now they have like 60,000 people in their community to come in and collaborate, compete on a design, work together to improve a design, and they produce this design for Berlin, what Berlin would need in 2030. Well, then Local Motors turned around and using Kanban process and a mix of techniques they've used in all the previous vehicles I showed you to create the first Olli in 90 days. A lot of it's 3D printed, but one of the most interesting things is 3D printing the tooling. So they 3D printed 25 molds in 3 days. So every single one of the big surfaces you see on the outside and inside of the vehicle, those were all stamped from 3D printed tooling. And then together, Local Motors and IBM, we co-created the cognitive rider experience. We prototyped that in 45 days. So design things, Scrum, iterative, you know, all together in the same room, in the same GitHub, and the whole. And some of the things that we use here, so, you know, the whole litany of Watson APIs, around the conversational aspects. We also did some interesting things like Olli crowdsourced local mobility. Well, Yelp is an amazing source of crowdsourced local knowledge. So we took Yelp's crowdsourced local knowledge and Olli crowdsourced local mobility and used Watson to mash those together. And then, you know, I liked how this was going with this whole crowdsourcing idea. So then we took the next step, which was crowdsourcing the education of Olli. So we opened it up first to all IBMers and got 10,000 Olli interactions the first day. So that helps with produce the training set. And then now we've opened it up so anyone in the local motors can take part and contribute. Architecture, blockitecture stuff. And then we'll talk about stuff I, this is the thing that I care the most about right now, and I hope is interesting to you. So if we can go ahead and play the second video.
Trying to find places is really a challenge, and that pertains to getting around as well, which is the number one most is really a challenge for somebody they can't see, because our world is made up of signs.
Excuse me, you know what,
trying to find places is really a challenge. I learned a long time ago that I should ask five people.
Let's try that again.
Directions to a place and then average the answer. And that's something we learned the hard way when you take one person's advice and you walk a mile the wrong direction and then have to double back 2 miles the other way and go the wrong direction.
I stepped on a nail, caused an infection, and I've been fighting it with my foot.
Yes.
There.
Okay.
And I'll just double click that.
Got it. Yeah. Let's start that over. Sorry about that. There we go.
Trying to find places is really a challenge, and that pertains to getting around as well, which is the number one most difficult thing for somebody if they can't see, because our world is made up of signs.
Excuse me, you know where B-Star 33 is?
I learned a long time ago that I should ask five people directions to a place and then average the answers. And that's something you learn the hard way when you take one person's advice and you walk a mile the wrong direction and then you have to double back 2 miles the other way to get where you were going.
I stepped on a nail, caused an infection, and I've been fighting it with my foot for the last 2 years. A lot of times couldn't drive, pretty much immobile the whole time.
Hi everyone, my name is Olli. I'm a self-driving vehicle powered by IBM Watson technology.
Mobility represents independence and freedom. And with Olli, we can ensure that our aging community and those with impairments can enjoy that quality of life.
IBM has a very rich heritage in accessibility. From the time we hired our first blind employee in 1914 to the technologies that we've developed over the last 100 years. Accessibility is all about creating an equal playing field for everyone.
We were excited to work with IBM in 2016 on the Outthink Aging Report. This was what impact cognitive computing can have on people.
IBM, local motors, and the CTA Foundation are working together to crowdsource new cognitive technology solutions with the goal of making Olli the world's most accessible self-driving vehicle.
Being able to build those partnerships, being able to work together, we're going to be able to do more than any one of us could do on our own.
Because we're looking for the best and the brightest people in the world, and we have to cultivate that talent at a young age to be sure that we have a diverse pool of applicants to be able to solve these big problems that IBM works on. So IBM is a primary sponsor of a program called PTECH.
And this is a collaboration, and so you're talking about how important it is for public and private industry to really rethink of the possibilities, so that way we are better preparing for the tomorrow.
Okay, this is not just for boys, but you can actually build fun stuff and fun people are doing it.
When you take autonomy and crowdsource industrial design and crowdsource local knowledge and crowdsourcing the education of the vehicle, and you put all those things together, we have an amazing opportunity to create accessible mobility for all the citizens of the world, not just the young and able-bodied.
So just show of hands, is this an interesting topic? Is this something you all would be interested in? So when they went to film this, they said that they needed elderly people with disabilities, so I gave them my parents. So that's actually my dad that you see in the video. He's a great guy, but he's completely uncoachable. You know, he's a military, he's a retired military pilot, flew in Vietnam, got shot down while defending Marines on the beach. His airplane blew up, took part of his knee with it, and so he's been hobbled his entire life. But does he say that in the video? No, he says, I stepped on a nail, it's hard to get around. Yeah, but he's a good guy. So our premise here is that accessibility is hard, right? This is a big problem that affects everybody. And you know, elderly, people with disabilities, you know, everyone in the room, you know somebody that this affects. And the ability to get around is a quite important one. And so our basic contention here is in the same way that you open source software and you open source industrial design and you do these things because it's too hard for any one person or any one organization to take it on themselves, we believe that solving accessibility, accessible mobility for all citizens is a problem that requires all of us to take part. And so what we've done is we've launched an effort in collaboration with the Consumer Technology Association Foundation, AARP, PTEC schools, MIT is now involved as well, and IBM Research, Local Motors, and a number of others. And what we're doing is we're going to be running a design challenge around different kinds of impairment issues combined with a set of hackathons. And the idea is to work through these problems and bring together the subject matter experts, right? So like AARP members and the youth. I think there's something really special when we can get, you know, the elderly and then the young people with no encumbrances, no preconceived notions, and you put them together to understand and try to solve these issues. And then how it'll ultimately manifest is we're going to put all this together in a OLLI exhibit, you know, center of CES 2018, in an entire exhibit of accessible accessibility technologies and showing how we can help solve these issues for all the citizens. So, you know, very excited about this. If there's any interest, if y'all want to take part, reach out, we'll get you involved. We're getting the challenge set up online. We'll have public GitHubs. There's a series of hackathons starting with AT Hack at MIT. Arizona State University is also involved. So Arizona State University Engineering professors and students are working with us. They've been creating a bunch of new, never before seen wheelchair ramps. So how do you do wheelchair ramps that are small and light, fit for a small EV electric vehicle, ramps that don't get in the way when not used, ramps that can deploy even if there's loss of power, and then combine that with machine vision so that Olli can automatically know, I see a wheelchair, I will deploy the wheelchair, the ramp. I will deploy the ramp in such a way that I don't hit the person in the wheelchair, right? So all of these kinds of problems are the sorts of things we would love your help with. So right out of the gate, you know, things we're focused on, mobility impairment. We can shorthand that for the moment, just to say wheelchair. Obviously that's not a complete enough definition. People with vision impairment. And so we have IBM research involved and we have people that are themselves blind that are part of this project. People with hearing loss and people with cognitive disability issues. So think about the aging for a moment, right? So if your grandmother calls Olli because she needs to go get bread from the grocery store, wouldn't it be nice if after, when it arrives at the grocery store, Olli reminds her, so Becky, don't forget, you're here to pick up bread, right? So, you know, how do you help people with Alzheimer's and other kinds of cognitive impairment issues? And so, you know, I think we have big potential for this. You know, I gave my kids these little 3D printed Ollies, and I explained to my boy, I said,
hey, Dash, you know what Daddy does? Daddy works on a robot. This is, Olli is a robot. It's a robot you talk to, and it takes you places. And he looked at it for a couple of seconds, and he goes, it's a robot? I talked to her? Yeah. He goes, Olli, take me to Legoland. And then he mimes running around the house, right? So, you know, if my little boy could understand intuitively how to use this mobility in a few seconds, I think it has a lot of potential. And that's my spiel.
You can hear us, right?
Absolutely.
Does anyone have questions? Yep, sure.
It's more a suggestion. The way I've been describing helping the elderly, and I'm an elderly person, but I don't think I'm the correct unit of analysis. What you need to think about is how families handle the elderly within them. So what I'm saying is, in thinking about all this, you shouldn't just be thinking about the elderly person, but the family is really the key to helping. So you ought to come up with systems that help the family help the elderly.
Absolutely. And the word, if you go to localmotors.com and click around, eventually you find Olli and the other projects. I can show that real easily. These are the kinds of ideas that what you can do is you can start tweeting on, I want to get out of this, get a browser, there's a browser, there's myself, I don't need to see myself, localmotors.com. So some of the things you see, in terms of the projects, labs, co-create with us, is you can go and contribute ideas and take part. And so they talk about, like for Olli, what are some of the problems, what are some of the tasks that they want the community to help with? They also do a lot of design contests. And so that's a great place to get involved, but even there's an accessible Olli tag and you can just tweak your ideas to that too. I can get out of this. Oh, there we go. Twitter's it's like a guilty pleasure. I'm slightly Twitter obsessed. But accessible Olli, you can find out who's working on it and get involved and start making suggestions and see some things are going on. So last week on Thursday, we were at Local Motors in Washington, D.C. with the P-Tech school, and working with them on what could we do for accessibility with all the kids. So we did design think sessions with the kids to come up with their ideas, okay? And we gave them personas. So Stevie Wonder, who obviously has vision issues, Octavia Spencer, she's dyslexic, and many others. And so we got involved around that. The next day we were at AARP and doing things with them around this. And then this week we're at MIT planning for the MIT AT Hack, which is coming up soon. You know, terrific event. It's the Accessible Technologies Hack. This is something fun. This is Ultra Haptics. It's haptics at a distance. It's an array of ultrasonic speakers that creates a feel that you can feel. So think of, and you combine that with leap motion gesture detection. Think about like seeing an object in AR, VR, or on a screen, and then being able to feel it in thin air, right? So we think, we don't know how we're going to use this in accessible technology, but we think it has a place. So let me get back out of this. And on the family topic, you know, one of the ideas that has already been written up but not coded yet is a Kindergetter. So it's the grandmother's ability to tell Olli to go get the grandkids and bring them to her.
Well, thank you very much.
Thanks, Joe. We appreciate it.
Oh,
I love it. All right. Well, we have our next speaker lined up. Thank you, Joe. I think he shared some of his Twitter info and stuff like that, so please feel free to reach out to him. Our next speaker is Michael Ludden.
Ludden,
sorry.
That's cool.
He's going to talk to us about artificial intelligence and virtual reality. Ooh, pretty cool. How many people are into VR? A good chunk of you. So with that, let's give a warm welcome to Michael.
Okay. I have a loud voice. Can you guys hear me okay? I can project. Hi. How are you guys?
Hi.
Everybody made it here safe? Nobody died in the storm of the century, although I heard that the previous speaker got into an accident, and that's why he's remote. That's crazy. I drove down last night from San Francisco. I drove instead of flew because I have family here and I'm going to spend the weekend. But yeah, it rained, but it was not like harrowing for me, but it rains every day in San Francisco, so it's all about what you're used to, I guess. And I did grow up in LA, and I remember freaking out every time it would rain and be like, oh my gosh, everyone's going to die. It's going to be just a horrible, horrible nightmare. And yet it never happened, so glad that's the case today as well. Okay, so here's my little brief presentation. So my name is Michael Ludden. I run an organization within IBM called Watson Developer Labs. I'm actually staffing up now for that, and I have a mini group within that called VRAR Labs. And this all came out of work that I did. Feel free to follow me on Twitter, or if you want to see random things that I post and that are my own, or check out my LinkedIn. We can connect after if anybody has any questions or is curious about anything. So I figured we'd basically just go through these four things. I know that somebody went over cognitive. I always like to put massive air quotes around that word. I'm going to go over specifically the Watson Developer Cloud Services. Did you guys do that already?
No.
Okay. So, all right, good. And then we're going to talk about I had a team build out of Austin with me. What can I call it? Like a VR experience which showcases interactive speech mechanisms powered by Watson. Get into that in a sec, and then some other stuff that I've done in the past with virtual reality and some Q&A. But actually, I took this slide out. I'm not sure why I did now. But my background is in developer relations and developer marketing. I joined IBM a little more than a year ago from Google, where I was a developer marketing manager lead for Google Play. Before that, I was at HTC. Before that, I was head of developer marketing at Samsung Mobile just before they launched the Gear VR, and at HTC way before they launched the Vive. And when I was at Google, they actually launched the first cardboard thing. Are you guys familiar with Google Cardboard? Basically, it's a piece of cardboard you fold up, you put your phone into it, works on iOS or Android. It's kind of like the worst experience you can have in VR, and a lot of people get sick, but it can kind of like give you that glimmer of, okay, I kind of see the point. So that was fun. I still have the Gen 1 at home. It's like a museum item. I'm sure I could sell it on eBay now. But so then I moved on to Watson, working in artificial intelligence at IBM and as a product manager. And since then, I've moved around a little bit. And one of the early things that I noticed was that there was a gap. I'm getting ahead of myself. First of all, I always need to give this a little spiel on Watson because people have seen all sorts of crazy commercials. I actually thought our Super Bowl commercial was the best one we've had so far. It was H&R Block powered by Watson. Which makes a lot more sense to me. I've always banged my head against the wall when I see Carrie Fisher talking to robots, rest in peace. But that commercial was really dumb because it told you nothing about Watson. Sorry if I'm offending any marketing people. But I loved the H&R Block one because it was, first of all, their commercial. And it's like, we're doing this stuff with Watson to make your taxes better. And then everybody in the world can be like, I kind of get it. I think I know. You know, Watson is helping companies do stuff they couldn't do. Okay. But this is what Watson actually is. This is what we call the Watson Developer Cloud. Internally, a lot of folks refer to it as Core Watson. It's essentially the pieces of Watson that developers can take and use. Oh, and I should say, I'm focused on developer products. As software eats the world, who here considers themselves a developer? Just wanted to sort of gauge the audience, okay. Who here has touched code with their mouse pointer? Well, hopefully. Okay, good. All right, so you guys are familiar. as software eats the world, developers become more and more important. And I think what a lot of folks realized, I wasn't at the company at the time, but when Jeopardy happened, when Watson won Jeopardy, a lot of folks in the company were like, man, it's hot here. A lot of folks in the company were like, we need to make this a product that's available for people, not just sort of a marketing stunt. What can we do? So they turned it into a cloud platform. It's all based in the cloud, accessed by people, by developers specifically, through REST APIs. And that means it's very easy to call these services and get responses back. I see some people nodding. And we expanded it from the five services that were used to basically make the conclusions and react and input response to the Jeopardy, to Alex Trebek, to win Jeopardy, into 30. So this doesn't show 30, but these are kind of the higher level buckets. There are four main ones, three main ones. Yeah, I guess they changed that. There's language. So we do a lot of natural language processing, parsing what somebody says, why they're saying it, how they're saying it, what they mean, what are the important themes. And it can do this in real time if you combine it with our speech stuff, speech to text, text to speech, which has a streaming option. So I could be speaking right now. I'm kind of tempted to give you guys some of these demos. If I have time later, I will. Just, but otherwise, if you want to explore it on your own, you can go to either Watson Developer, or that's not very good. Just Google Watson Developer Cloud, it'll take you to this page. Then there's visual recognition, and that basically is computer vision. So I take a picture of this, and it says there are 15 people in this photo, and there's seven females, and these are their age ranges, and nobody's smiling because everybody wants to look serious. He's kind of smiling. You know, that kind of thing. There's rain in the background. Like, it'll give you that information. But with visual recognition and with a lot of our other stuff, you can actually... Oh, no, there are four main sections. Good, they took that other one out. Good, I'm glad. You can actually custom train your own logic on top of it using our system, which you then own. So imagine if there's a picture of an apple, and the system can recognize that. But can it recognize that it's like a South Carolinian Granny Smith apple with a weevil in it? No, but you could absolutely train a system which subclassifies beyond what any general purpose computer vision API that any company offers can do. And I think that's a feature that differentiates us. It's also true in our chatbot training service, which is called Watson Conversation. You can train custom models and bias the results for specific industries. So think along the lines of an auto insurance claims bot or customer assistance bot. It may know industry specific nomenclature without you having to specifically train it. You just feed it a corpus of data and a custom model comes out that a general purpose bot trained on a general purpose bot correction platform, error handling platform, wouldn't do, if that makes sense. If I've lost anybody, let me know. Sometimes I go fast, and I know there's a lot of contingencies, so I want to make sure I make it clear. And then there's data insights, and we're adding to that. There's a new service called Watson Discovery, which I don't see there, which is very weird. But I took the screenshot last night. Anyway, I'll have to look at that. But you can go check this out yourself. Every demo or every service has an attached demo that you can take and play around with, and shows you all the features. There's some really cool stuff. I would specifically recommend checking out Watson Conversation, because it lets you train a chatbot super quick, and visual recognition, because you know it's visual, we're all visual people, and it's kind of easy to say, oh, okay, cool, similarity search is cool, oh, this is how I train it, that's pretty easy, I can see the value. And if you're more adventurous, you can go to starter kits, and there's some like amalgamated apps from multiple APIs, and you can fork any of our demos or any of our apps on GitHub and redo it yourself, alter it a little bit, push a production product if you want. What did I see at the beginning of last year that led me to VR? I saw that HTC was coming out with the Vive, which was going to be the first room-scale virtual reality system. And that means I could actually walk around parts of this room and touch stuff with a touch controller, and I would be perfectly tracked, and I would basically inhabit this space in a way that Gear VR and Google Daydream and others just frankly don't do. It's called 6DOF, 6 degrees of freedom. That's like an industry term now. It's becoming very quickly. 6DOF. And what mobile headsets do is 3DOF, 3DOF. And that means you can go up, left, and pitch, yaw, kind of thing, right? But you can't go forward. I can't like lean into who I'm talking to or what I'm doing, right? Or go backwards, let alone step around. And honestly, I have to say, that totally changes the game. So I played around with Vive through some of my old contacts at HTC, and I thought, this is interesting, but Vive's only available on Windows. And there are other platforms being deployed to other systems, right? There's Gear VR for Android, there's Oculus Rift for Windows, but it uses different plugins, and some of their games aren't available on Steam, which is all that Vive is available on. in addition to their own app store. And so what could a cloud-based platform do that would be interesting? Oh, well, I guess you could build once and then deploy to whatever platform you want, even PlayStation VR, in the future if you used a cloud platform. The one contingency is you have to be always online in order to send and make and receive API calls, right, and receive JSON files in return. But turns out there's a real market for that because that's where the future is. Everybody is always on and always connected. Even PlayStations, you're always connected to the internet, generally updating things in the background, talking to your friends. There's really no, and the second thing that I noticed was that every single virtual reality headset has a microphone. The Vive has a microphone, the Rift has a microphone, the Gear VR has a microphone, Google Daydream's phones have a microphone. And I was walking around these virtual worlds basically as a mute without a mouth, right? I could touch things, I could look at them, I couldn't speak. No one was really thinking about vocal interaction. And one of the nice things about our platform is it lets you go from A to Z really quickly. So as opposed to having to train a locally based, like Windows 10 speech recognition system, so that it can recognize keywords, which is the most basic implementation of speech recognition, and it's really hard to implement, we could get them to, oh, it can always be listening and have you have a full conversation and parse out everything you say and mean, assign that to an intent, like a bot, and then have the game world react. So I thought, what would be the best way to showcase this? Because I knew nobody inside of IBM, no offense, would get what I'm talking about without me showing the value first, right? The virtual reality, we're not a gaming company, we're a very serious enterprise company. And I have to go back and say, well, I said virtual reality, I didn't say gaming. There are actually tons of emerging productivity and therapeutic and training use cases that are already being prototyped today. I mean, it's moving so fast. Things from, just the other day I was working with somebody on an installation for the Toronto Raptors basketball team, and they have a virtual war room where they serve up Moneyballs type statistics. And you can imagine being able to parse what player you should draft in a minority report style way that can serve you up information. And they're trying to layer in vocal interaction to that. And I've talked to companies that have like a baseball bat with a special accessory attached to the bottom. You don't have the freedom of your hands, and right now you can't use your voice, so you have to like awkwardly look to the left and wait for a menu to spin up so that you can restart. But wouldn't it be better if I could say, hey, can I see that pitch again in slow motion, and can you track what I'm doing here? That is absolutely possible today with Watson. So, long story short, we had a Unity SDK, that was the third thing I noticed. We had a Unity SDK, which makes it very easy to call any Watson service from right within the most popular 3D development environment in the world, which is Unity. So I thought, let's build something to showcase what's possible with Vive, which is the most immersive, and with which you're most likely to speak to something and have it react and be like, oh, that's awesome. And with Watson, which is a cloud-based platform. So I had this thing, which we changed the name of, called IBM Speech Sandbox Built. And let me see if I can show you the link here. This is a link to the YouTube video. It's essentially a sandbox environment. It drops you into a world. You're standing and looking around, and you can create, modify, and destroy objects with just your voice. So we have a system running on the back end. It uses just two services, speech to text, it's always listening in narrowband streaming mode, and Watson Conversation, our chatbot service, and you'll see what these people do. The demo's wholly
Welcome
focused
to the sandbox,
on vocal interaction,
powered by
not
Watson SDK for
pretty Unity. Visuals and whatnot.
Today you'll discover how to manipulate your virtual world with voice.
So basically, there are 200 objects in this world, and I meant this as a showcase for developers, and then there's an accompanying how-to guide, which I'll show you in a second. So,
if out here, you can create a large number of objects.
The other thing I wanted to do was I wanted to get people thinking outside the box, so I didn't build a chatbot. I didn't build a fake Watson that you could talk to and be like, hello, how are you? I could have done that. But I wanted people to think about other ways you could use conversational interfaces in virtual reality. And this was at the beginning of 2016, and since then, I've gotten so much interest from companies outside of IBM and also other IBMers. I'm eager to get us in more stuff because I think this is the thing. And I've already seen articles from some of our competitors coming out with similar solutions elsewhere. And it's kind of a moment where we can either win or not. So this is showing how you could use a chatbot infrastructure type of deal where all the error handling happens server side in the cloud automatically. Like you could say, create a big green dragon, and it would know that create means make, and big means large, or whatever the intent is, and green is turquoise, but probably green, and dragon is the object, and it will create that particular type of dragon with your modifications right there in the world. So you can see that happening now.
Interact with each other.
If you need some suggestions on what you can create, just ask, what can I create? And I'll tell you some of my favorites.
Create a big gorilla.
And these are all making live
videos. Create a small gorilla.
So I think the most powerful piece of the system is the fact that it can parse modifiers, and it's not hard to actually get the game world to switch out a shader or change the scale based on what you're saying. And so suddenly, all sorts of insane things that are not possible in the real world are possible in virtual reality. And oh, by the way, of course, I'd love if somebody in this room takes this idea and then goes and builds a virtual person that I can talk to. And that hasn't happened yet. Yeah, and then you can play around with them. It's the rest of this is fun. I'll let you finish it, though. And this is available now. If anybody has a Vive, we're also doing a build for Daydream. But if you want to try the Vive version, it's freely available on HTC Vive's App Store. I'll give you the link in just a sec. But yeah,
create a rocket launcher.
She created all these cars, different colors, right? Different sizes, maybe. And now she's just going to destroy them all. It's terrible. She's terrible. She's so violent. So, I had to beg, steal, and borrow to even get this built. And there were some battles that I was willing to fight. Like, hey, this is what the vocal interaction needs to do. And there were others like, take all the guns out. Okay, Mr. like tween boy in a man's body. So I didn't fight that battle. And so there are guns, but that's not the point. It's just boys playing with toys, right? It's actually called IBM Speech Sandbox. This is the how-to guide. If anybody's interested at all in this concept, I recommend checking the guide out. It is not as exhaustive as I would like, so make sure you get my contact info from the last slide I'll show you. But it should get you started. If you have some experience in Unity, you can rebuild it in like an hour, play around with it. I mean, I've thought of a number of different use cases for this, and some partners are working on them. I mean, imagine there was a surgeon VR demo that where they're teaching surgeons how to do surgery, right? And so what if you could actually ask the nurse for a scalpel instead of hitting some menu button that takes you out of the experience and also doesn't train you on a real world situation, right? So nurse, scalpel M5, please. You know, what if she hands you the wrong one? Maybe that becomes part of the exercise. No, not that one, a different one, right? That's an example. Or if you're thinking gaming, you know, what if it's a World War II simulator and you're out of ammo? Right now what these games make you do is they make you do some motion or drop another clip in. But what if you don't want to always lean down to the ground? And what if there's like a co-op buddy? What if you could say and make it a game mechanic, hey, I'm out, hand me a clip. And they throw a clip and you have to grab it and put it in. That'd be a lot more fun and immersive, right? And there's some more serious stuff around therapy and retraining people who have had strokes to regrow the part of their brain that can control their bodies and recover full motion. That actually is working now. There are some early prototypes with Kinect that they're looking to bring into VR. But you can essentially trick your brain to build new gray matter using VR. And there's a ton of stuff like I worked and actually implemented this code in a training company's production code for dangerous construction sites. So you have to go around and point at different things that are wrong, like, oh, that's a bandsaw that's running and open. That's dangerous. And we just did a very basic proof of concept functionality. But a lot of these companies that aren't around gaming and aren't even really around productivity, like training and therapy, are seeing a lot of value, especially when there are peripherals and your hands can't go to some sort of menu or UI, right? Voice makes a lot of sense and is almost necessary. I was in a fire hose game. Last example for this I'll give. Because it was crazy at CES. That's when I launched this officially in HTC's App Store. And there was a fireman training demo where you put on a fire coat that has like heaters in the pocket. And you have an actual fire hose that when you pull it, it physically pulls you back. Like it would really pull you if water were coming out. And you're in the game, and you're supposed to put out a fire in the kitchen. So you're like, oh my gosh, I'm getting hot. And what if I needed to pause? I can't pause. I can't do anything. I'm just like holding this thing. But what if I could just say, can you pause, or can we restart, or what am I supposed to do? You know, there's any number of different, the writing's on the wall. This is all going to happen. Mark my words. This year, probably, in VR, there's going to be much, much more vocal interaction. There already is. So that's the guide, ibm.biz/watson_VR. So just some comments. If anybody's a nerd here, the fact that Veronica Belmont stopped by the booth to try it out was pretty cool for me. I don't know, she's an old school podcast person. This is where I first showed it off in really rough form. We had a Pikachu model in the demo. And that's where I met the folks from SVVR, which is the largest virtual reality group, and they're having a conference in just a few weeks, which I'm speaking at, and giving a talk much like this, actually. They were awesome. Actually, that's where I got interest from some industry companies first. And this was just the most terrible-looking demo you could ever imagine, but it got people's light bulbs going off as to the possibilities. I'm sorry, before I move on too much, I thought I put the link to the Viveport app store. So if you Google Viveport IBM Speech Sandbox, it should be the first result. And you can download it if you have an HTC Vive. And again, I'm working to get all the code open source on GitHub, so anybody can just take and fork it for both this build and the Daydream build, and eventually other builds like the Rift and stuff. But yeah, you can just install it for free and try it out and rebuild it yourself. That's the whole point of it. So before I did that, actually, but after I had started the project, I worked with NVIDIA and SVVR after having met them in LA to do a hackathon around visual recognition. And it was so cool to see what people came up with around visual recognition in virtual reality. So they came up with and this is an article that NVIDIA wrote about this. You can go look it up if you want. But basically a symbol recognition system using our custom trainability for visual recognition. Still with me? So the fact that you can custom train it to recognize very specific things. In this case, they created a tool, which is open source now on GitHub, anybody can use it, to retrain the service to recognize whatever you want. So in this case, it was, they created a system in a game, you can kind of see the keys here, where a user would make a drawing in the game using the Vive controllers, and they draw a key, let's say, or a ladder, in this case a key, and then it'll send that to the visual recognition service, and using the custom trained classifiers, it will say that's a key. Well, if you know anything about this, there's no visual computer vision system in the world that would recognize a hand-drawn key in a virtual environment as a key. That would actually be a false positive and would cause a terrible experience for other people who want to actually search for a key, right? Images of a key. So they trained this completely custom. And not only that, but they've created the tool so that anybody could do it. And then they deployed it in this game. And it's really smart because what it actually submits to the service is a black and white image, where the black is whatever they drew and the white is the background. So it doesn't see actually the 3D background, which makes it really simple for it. If you give it 10 to 50 images of what this is, for the system to be like, that's a key. And what happens next is a 3D key populates in the world and you can go unlock a door. These are all sort of prototype-y things, but you can imagine how the next logical step is making them real UI components, real gameplay components, real ways in which people can learn things in a spatial way, which helps everybody. We're very spatial creatures. I was just going a little off the rails, but I was listening to a VR research podcast last night as I drove to LA, and it was talking about how our spatial memory is so strong. There's a company doing photogrammetry. Photogrammetry is where you take a picture that's like 360, but then you do it everywhere in this room so that I can actually go back in virtual reality and walk around this room. And what they found was people who had been to, they mentioned a specific example, like a German castle. Like 5 years ago, they're like, oh, I know this place. No, spatial memory is like really strong. So that's another aspect of why virtual reality is really interesting. So what's next for me is I'm building a VR AR labs, and I'm actually hiring for that. And I just realized I was on a university, so I might as well make a little plug. So take a picture if you're interested, but I need someone who has a perspective about virtual reality, who is interested in building something from nothing and working with IBM technology stack, specifically Watson, and creating either product layers or SDKs or useful tutorials that are geared towards VR developers so that they know some of the easy, low-hanging fruit use cases that they can have to build really awesome, cool stuff, and also to work with partners on this stuff. The first low-hanging fruit is we need to get that demo open source on GitHub. We need more like it. We need different ways that this stuff is deployed because this is so blue ocean and it's so early. And so I've taken the little bit of cachet that somehow IBM made the mistake of giving me, and I'm going to parlay that into a real push to make us a thought leader in the VR AR space, even despite ourselves. So if you're interested in taking on a task like that and working with like a fast moving team and you feel like you have the right skills and background, or you're just hungry enough, please take a screenshot. Good, okay. So that's pretty much my talk. The one thing I think that I didn't talk enough about, I do want to take Q&A, is our Watson conversation service. So in the cognitive VR, the IBM speech sandbox demo, what's happening in the program itself is really almost none of the logic. All it's doing is matching what the system tells the game that you said to a 3D object in the game and modifying it accordingly, right? Replacing the shader, altering the size and scale as you deem, and you can get more granular with that. But everything that happened on the back end is what happened in what we call a workspace. So I have one here. I don't know, how much time do I have left? I'm not going to go into
3 minutes.
Okay. So I mean, it's hard to explain to people that haven't tried to do this, build this stuff locally, but this abstracts a level of difficulty that is insane. I mean, I just saw a game called Event Zero where they spent the last 8 years building what our service lets anybody do in like 5 minutes, and they built it all locally for their like faked AI engine, which is really interesting. I think it constitutes some best practices. But really, they should have built the platform. If they had done that, they would win. And so this stuff is non-trivial. I always like to use a dummy account just so that I feel real user pain. I'm trying to be the change I want to see at IBM so that we dog food our own stuff more. Dog fooding is when you use your own products, by the way, in case you don't know that. So if I go into my conversation workspace that I've created, I'm not going to go too into the weeds. This is actually a UI. It's not really code. Hello. Okay, here we go. So there's a custom model you can get, or you can just use the normal model. Yeah, we have some single sign-on hurdles to cross yet. So if I go into my workspace, this is what it looks like. So this is a chatbot, and you can test it as you're training it. And really, we use this for the virtual reality demo because it's just the backend, right? So somebody says, create a large green dragon. This isn't that one, so it's going to say nothing. It's just going to like repeat itself. But let's see. What did I put? I put welcome. How can I help you? Go away. I'm busy. So yeah, this one is just like randomizer. I wanted to just basically show that it could either say welcome. How can I help you? Or go away. I'm busy eating. Depending on randomization. So this is what a conversation workspace would be. You can imagine dialogue trees that branch out like crazy and say, okay, I'm going to first say this, and then the user says this, and then you have your error handling null one, which is down here. So if it doesn't understand, it'll be, I'm sorry, I didn't understand that, can you repeat that? But what's important to note is that when you train a specific intent like good day, I can give this five things, and it will still classify other things as this based on its own logic, its own internal logic, which, if you want to get really advanced, you can customize on the back end. But if you don't, it's excellent. So imagine I said, howdy, right? I didn't put that as a sample user entry, but it is definitely going to parse that as a greeting. And you can the other cool piece is you can train this, you can test it as you're training it. So let's say howdy, okay, that's a greeting, see? And if it's not a greeting, if there's another intent, you can change that. Another cool feature of this is when you look at user conversations, if I connect this to the app, to the IBM Speech Sandbox, I can see every conversation people have had, what Watson thought it meant, and I can correct it. So I'm actually improving the model. So it's like, well, obviously this is not a greeting. He just said, fuck you, go away, right? And so I can say, this is null, so it didn't understand. Or I can create another thing that's like, you swore at me, I'm ending the program, you know, whatever. But you can kind of see where the power is. And then with the speech to text, it's best in class. I'm really confident about the speech to text aspect of what we used in the demo. You use that, it's always listening, you don't need a wake word. It passes what you said to the service and it gets more intelligent about your particular speech patterns over time. So now I think I'm rambling. So maybe a couple questions and I'll get out of your way and you can tweet me or send me a note on LinkedIn. Any questions? I'm sure I raised more questions than I answered. Well, yeah.
So does it understand kind of the property? So let's say like you have the gorilla, right?
Yeah.
So maybe then you want to say, well, make the arms twice as big, but keep the body the same size.
Yeah.
It will be able to.
Yeah, it could do that. That depends on you making sure that the game world is populated, and I say game world in quotes, the virtual world that you build is populated with a gorilla model that can have modifiable arms. So maybe the model is actually three models, where it's the gorilla torso, and then the gorilla arm right, gorilla arm left, but it always populates together unless a user specifies that the right arm should be bigger, and then it would modify the size of just that thing. But it's really, it's all about the logic you build locally, but certainly the system could give you back that information. They want the left arm big or something, or both arms big. Absolutely. Yeah, good question. So it's cool, right? I mean, it could be as cool as you want it to be, really. This is just meant to be a starter idea. Like, this isn't IBM trying to produce content. This is IBM trying to produce best practices and make it easy for you to produce content, or whoever developer. Any other questions? One more, maybe? Zero more? Okay. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
All right, guys. I'd like to introduce Bryan Cunningham. He's going to talk to us about cybersecurity. And then afterwards, we'll actually break for lunch, and then there's an info session after lunch. All right, let's give Bryan a warm hand.
Good morning, everyone. So first of all, I have the coveted right before lunch spot. And second of all, I have to follow that. I have no virtual reality, I have no slides. And I promise you, my teenage daughters have never said to me, you can make yourself as cool as you want to be. So I'm just gonna talk about cybersecurity for a few minutes and then turn you guys loose to lunch. One of the blessings and curses of being in cybersecurity is no matter when I speak where, there's always headlines to talk about. I just pulled my news feed a couple minutes ago, and I'll just mention three. Ukraine has announced that there has been a new wave of Russian cyber attacks against their government, 6,500 separate attacks over the last couple months. And mind you, these are almost certainly the same groups that hacked the DNC and John Podesta and tried to influence our election. Cyber attacks have caused Yahoo, for the business students in the room or the entrepreneurs, to take a $300 million cut in the amount of money that Verizon is paying them to buy their company. And the city of Windsor, Canada, has announced that they have been held hostage by ransomware attacks, the entire city. Those three bullet points are in the last 48 hours. Not to mention Russia and our elections and the Netherlands elections and the German elections and the French elections. The Netherlands has gone for the first time in 15 years back to 100% paper ballots. They pulled every single electronic voting machine out of their country because they don't believe they can protect them from Russian attack. Germany, France, facing the same thing. I'm the executive director of UCI's new Cybersecurity Policy and Research Institute. I say new, we just had our 6-month anniversary a couple days ago, so I guess we're grizzled old veterans on campus now. This is a unique effort in a couple ways. One is it's multidisciplinary. So we have participation from this ICS school. In fact, even though I'm a lawyer by training and I was an intelligence officer for 15 years, my office is about 500 feet that way in the ICS building. Thank you, ICS. We have engineering, we have law, we have business, we have social science, social ecology, physical science, which is where our cryptography is, and medicine so far. And I'm quite certain that soon we're going to hit some ethical question, that we're going to need a philosopher, and we'll have the School of Humanities involved as well. We have three missions. The first one is a training mission. That was our original founding mission, to help design high quality, constantly evolving cybersecurity and digital evidence handling training for police departments. We've already run our first 40-hour course for the LA Sheriffs, LAPD, and Orange County Sheriffs, which was successful from their point of view. We'll probably ultimately expand that to include also other members of the justice system, defense attorneys, prosecutors, judges, and then move into other verticals like the defense industrial base and infrastructure. Second of our missions, and I'm going through this quickly so that you can all get to lunch, is community engagement. So on Wednesday, we had a meeting of 70 plus interested participants from all across critical infrastructure. All critical infrastructure sectors were represented. We had financial, we had defense, we had law enforcement, we had cybersecurity companies. And we used those meetings to try to develop a research agenda for coordinating and funding and supporting research on our campus that can have real world impacts on the many cybersecurity problems that we have. Also in community engagement, I'm very happy to announce that we're going to start for the fall of 2017 a cyber victims defense clinic. So this will take applications from law students on the legal side, computer science, engineering students, and others. And the idea is that you serve in the clinic, you learn about cybersecurity, victims can come in, they bring in their device, This will probably be a lot of targeted populations, elderly and underserved folks. The engineering computer science will be supervised by Cylance, the local cybersecurity, can I say local plus $100 million infusion of capital from Google a couple of years ago. They supervise on the technical side. We have a great law professor and the law partner supervising on the legal side. Victims can get technical help, stop the bleeding on the device, mitigate the damage, help them make sure they don't get scammed again, and then legal help. If they have a criminal complaint, we'll package that up for them, take it to the authorities, civil lawsuit the same. That's going to be available in the fall of 2017. Should be out in the catalogs in March or April or whenever they come out. Separately, we're working on a curriculum for Santa Ana and Anaheim Unified High Schools in cybersecurity. Not with the idea that you're going to graduate from high school and go get a cybersecurity job at IBM, for example, but with the idea that these are underprivileged kids who might not go to college. You get them interested in something that's exciting, and we know there's 2 million jobs at the end of that cybersecurity pipeline, and they may go to community college, might go to college and study cybersecurity. And then finally, we have a research mission, and the research mission is grounded by a couple of rules. One is we're going to try to tackle hard problems at the intersection of policy, law, and technology, and do it in a very multidisciplinary way, so cutting across as many disciplines as we can. We have two research programs underway right now, which I'll just mention briefly. One is around electronic voting, trying to take a supply chain end-to-end look at the voting process, not just hacking the machines, which Cylance and our people have already done easily, but also looking at where are the machines purchased, what are their components, what's the security when they're assembled, what's the security in transportation, what's the security at the polls, and how is that information handled afterwards? Because our concern is that it's a little bit still in the news right now, but the next couple of years will go by, it'll be 2019, and people will say, hey, I wonder if the Russians can hack our electronic voting machines. So we want to try to get ahead of that. And that's being led by a great assistant professor in the engineering school and a couple of law faculty. The other one we have initially is around attribution, the ability to publicly and verifiably prove who your attacker is in a cyber attack. And I practiced cybersecurity and privacy law for about 10 years in my own law firm in the private sector, and typically you talk about these attribution issues with chief information security officers and others, and they'll say, well, it's not that important to us to know who is attacking us and why. What we care about is finding how it's being done, stopping it, and preventing it from being done again. I think that view is changing, though, because now we have issues like the Obama administration and the Trump administration fighting about whether it actually was the Russians that hacked our tried to hack our election. And the methodologies for proving that, particularly in public without using classified information, are, to say the least, primitive. So we're taking a look at two aspects of that. One is, what should the standards of proof be? If you want to sanction another country, if you want to respond with a cyber attack of your own, if you want to convict somebody in a criminal court, if you want to have a civil lawsuit, if you just want to catch bullies in high school and cyberspace, how much proof should you need and what kind of proof? And then on a much broader multidisciplinary endeavor, we're going to try to take a look at whether other disciplines besides just computer science, I hate to say this in the ICS building, but other disciplines can also bring expertise to bear on this problem of attribution. Can psychologists help figure out the psychological, the behavioral profiling of attackers? Can cultural anthropologists successfully make a contribution in looking at the differences in behavior between the different groups? Can linguists contribute? Can cryptographers contribute, et cetera? So those two projects are underway. The amount of actual detailed, broad scientific work we'll be able to do is going to depend a little bit on funding sources, which we're working on. So we have training, we have the clinic and the other outreach, we have research, and part of the goal is ultimately to make Orange County a cybersecurity ecosystem, a place where new companies continue to come in and where there's plenty of jobs in this area. And I would just add one other thing. Since we're at an IBM event, we have a fantastic executive committee for our institute, and this includes the American Civil Liberties Union and the Center for Democracy and Technology and Rockwell Collins and Cylance and a number of other companies, including we have on our executive committee the global remediation lead for IBM's new cybersecurity effort centered in Orange County. It's the X for Iris Incident Response and Intelligence Services Company division. And So these folks are giving us great guidance on how we should prioritize our efforts, because one of the biggest problems in cybersecurity, and I found this when I was in the government and when I was in the private sector and now, is there's so many issues that you could be working on that would have a meaningful impact. How do you triage and decide which ones to work on first? And that's part of what we're gonna be using our executive committee for. So that was a tidy 10 minutes. I can probably take a couple questions if anybody has any. Yes, sir.
The obvious one, if people want to follow the activities of this group, what's a good URL or way?
It's cpri.uci.edu. It is under construction, so you'll be able to find basic information about the Institute, but especially those who are web designers here, don't hold me accountable for how it looks. This is going to be improved in the last couple months, in the next couple months. Anyone else? Okay, thanks. Have a good lunch.
All right, guys. Before you all bail, couple of quick things. First, let's thank all of our speakers. I think they did a phenomenal job. In particular, let's thank ICS for hosting us, as well as Shauna, Kat, Nancy, and various other people that helped actually organize this event. They did an amazing job. All right. For those of you who are interested in learning more about IBM, career opportunities, internships, we have an information session that starts about 1:15 in this room. Until then, we're going to break for lunch. Lunch is actually one floor down in room 5011. I invite you all to come attend, socialize, and meet some of the speakers and other folks here. All right? Thanks.